I was thinking, can you hear me or I'm in this office? And I was thinking, what can I say? Did you bring the English? It's all right if I speak English? Yeah. Who can absolutely not understand? All right.
There is a translation.
Anyway, I was thinking that just a moment before the BDS prevails, I see all you young people and I said, I would like to take you with me for a week or two in my daily work as a lawyer, as it was said before, and show you what it is on the grounds. And you will realize very, very quickly that the Israeli attitude towards the Palestinians, both inside Israel, in the occupied Jerusalem, East Jerusalem, in the occupied territories of Gaza and the West Bank, is breaking each day all the elementary values and principles of the international law, one by one. And if you come with me, I'll take you, for instance, to the very holy places that are in the center of the old city of Jerusalem, the old occupied city of Jerusalem. On the one hand, the Wailing Wall, the important churches, and Al-Aqsa. And you know, you must know if you are here in this room, that there is a fight over the Al-Aqsa that is called by Israel, the holy Israeli place, the holy shrine. And if you see the, if you get into Al-Aqsa, there are special hours that tourists can get in, you will see those many old people sitting there, Muslims, praying day and night. But I can take you just as well to a nearby place, which is the court of Jerusalem, the magistrate court in Russian compounds, not so far, walking distance. And you will see one of those halls of the court, those same old people sitting there for trial, because they are considered an illegal organization, since they are sitting praying in Al-Aqsa in order to attend the place and to prevent the what they see as a possible attack by the Israelis and an attempt to take it over. At the same court, which I visit daily, you will see another room where there is a trial against a student in Bethlehem University. But he's a Jerusalemite, so he will be sentenced in Israel and not in the military court that is in Ofra camp, in the military camp, not far from, between Jerusalem and Ramallah. So being with an Israeli identification card, he is being brought to a regular Israeli magistrate court. And he is charged there for being a member of an illegal organization. So that while he is in his university in Bethlehem, he is leading, together with others, a student movement that supports Islam. And therefore, since he was distributing this ideology of the Islam in the University of Bethlehem, he has been brought to trial in Israel, since this student organization, together like with hundreds of other organizations, was declared an illegal organization. So the freedom of expression, the freedom of opinion, the freedom of religion is very fragile. If I take you again, not far away from there, to my office, for instance, at any given Friday, you will see how, what is the situation with the freedom of movement. People who live in Gaza, of course, you know it very well, are under total siege. They cannot go in, they cannot go out, and every exit or entry depends on the decision or the goodwill of the Israelis, and they have no goodwill whatsoever. But there are urgent cases. There is someone who wants to visit her family in Gaza. How would she ever get there? Someone who has to started to study, let's say, in university in Birzeit 10 years ago, but since then she's stuck in the West Bank. She cannot go back to Gaza. It involves, again, the academic freedom. Students from Gaza cannot study anymore in the West Bank or, of course, vice versa. So these people have to go out or in, and it totally dependent on the Israeli authorities. This is part of the daily work of human rights organizations, of private lawyers like me, and of other Palestinian organizations who try somehow to maneuver between all the licenses that are necessary for everything. The freedom of movement in the West Bank itself is limited. There is practically apartheid between the areas where there are settlements and the areas where there are Palestinian villages or towns, and you cannot just go freely over the West Bank. There are zones, special licenses. There is the well-known illegal internationally separation wall that practically separates between the West Bank and what Israel calls Israel, but it includes many annexed territories after 67. And again, there is all this licensing of transferring, of moving around, of coming. You will see in these courts that I mentioned, both in the military courts and in our civil courts inside Israel, you will see all those youngsters and all those who try to jump over the wall or were caught illegally in Israel, and it's a whole daily mess of, I would say, tens of people all over the country who are illegal workers or attend illegally in Israel. They are illegal workers, so they would be detained, but the contractors who use them will be free, of course, because they want this cheap mobile manpower. Another right that is very actual nowadays is the right for dwelling. People have the right to live somewhere, not in a tent, in a house. And there are many areas that since 1948 already shifted hands. The Palestinians that were expelled in 48, and after the division of Jerusalem at the end of the war, some parts became Jordanian. And in that Jordanian pass, there have been some houses of the Jews before 48. Nowadays, according to the different courts decision, each house that used to belong before 48 to Jews is now used by the settlers, by a very strong settler movement, in order to evict the Palestinian population that was living there ever since 1948. It is not done to those Arab houses who are now inhabited by Jews on the other part of the same Jerusalem. So now, if you would join me to this trip, we'll go to Sheikh Jarrah, which is annexed to Israel now, but it is in the what used to be Jordan before 67. And you'll find, on one hand, those settlers with big flag usually on the house that are in the midst of the Palestinian territory, the Palestinian house, neighborhood, and they took over because they managed to evict the Palestinian tenant. I'm happy to say that there are so many Israelis that identify with this evil, and they come, they manifest, they follow this population. We were just in the New Year's Eve, we had a big, big dinner together in the streets with Palestinians and Israelis. The same day was the New Year's, the Islamic New Year and the Jewish New Year. So there is a struggle, but it's not a big struggle, and we already, he was talking already about the situation of the Israeli, but this is one of the still existing reactions. If we continue, we will meet a group of Israelis who voluntarily go to the areas near Gaza, the entry to Gaza, I would say port or the border of Gaza, or to the West Bank, and they transfer ill people to be treated in the Israeli hospitals. I don't think there's something, that fact is something that Israel has to be proud of, because we know it's over 50, it's now it's 50 years of Israeli control over the occupied territories. And although recently it's under direct control, some parts were given back to the Palestinian Authority, but still Israel controls it overall. Just as well as we've withdrawn from Gaza, but we still control it. And I think it's a shame that Israel in those long years of occupation have only built settlements and never a good medical system in the occupied territories. So when you have very specific, difficult cases, they are allowed to come and be treated in Israel for a good payment, of course. And we can see these shifts of Israelis who are going to help and bring the ill people, but again, the right for health or health care does not exist. The right to have a family, the right to have children, the right of the children to have parents. I don't know how you are acquainted, if you are acquainted with all this bureaucracy, but you should know that there's no automatic right to any Palestinian to live with a spouse. There are all kinds of limitations built during the years in order to minimize the number of Palestinians or Arabs who would come and live with the Palestinians. For instance, it's a well-known, very accepted habit, I would say, of Palestinian who has, let's say, he's from Ramallah and he has a cousin in Amman, to marry her, right? Yeah, it's part of the family. You marry who is part of other parts of the family. Or an Israeli Palestinian from the Galilee, from Nazareth, who wants to marry a Palestinian from the West Bank. There are limitations that make it almost impossible. And the difficulty is not only when can you start, when can you ask for family reunification. The man should be at least 35 years old, the woman at least 25 years old. This is an elementary limitation. And then, if he's less than 35, he cannot live with you if you are an Israeli or a Jerusalemite. So he should, if he doesn't live with you, he will not get the family reunification once he's grown up enough to live with you. And the children cannot be registered automatically. So there are divided families, and everyone is working around the clock. If I would take you, in this case, to the Ministry of Interior, that is in East Jerusalem, you will see a catastrophe lining up of people who demand their elementary rights just for, as I said, family life. children, children that would have their parents. It's all concentrated there, and with so much agony. And you would say the Israeli control over Palestinians who are Israelis. No. It goes also to the West Bank right now. Just before I came here, there's this new case, but it's one of many because the policy has changed and nobody knows how and when. That if a resident of the West Bank, a Palestinian, has a foreign spouse, I would say, I'll give the example without the name, yes, an Italian musician who came to teach in a music academy in the West Bank and Jerusalem at the same time. And he's been here for 8 years. He got the visas as a worker, permissions, he was living here. And then he fell in love with another Palestinian music teacher, and they got married, and they have a small daughter. And then all of a sudden, a new policy is introduced that since he's a foreigner, since he needs a visa, he will not get a visa unless he signs a declaration that he's not going to work in the West Bank, and he will get a visa for 2 weeks for a family visit. The intention is very clear, to encourage such a family to immigrate, in this case to Italy, and not to remain in the West Bank. They don't want to add more so-called Palestinians or spouses of Palestinians if it's not necessary. Another Turkish woman, a Palestinian studied in Turkey, he married a Turkish woman. This woman, whenever she wants to come and visit, she cannot live with him. Whenever she wants to come and visit, she has to deposit over 10,000 American dollars, and she gets it only after she leaves the country. It's a daily thing nowadays that's concerning the right of having a family. Other cases, I put it under the headline of the right for freedom, the right to fight the occupation. So, okay, of course, if you put bombs, you'll end up in prison. If you throw stones, it's called nowadays popular terror, you will end up in prison and for a long time. And you'll end up in prison also if you are very, very young. They amended now again the law that even if you are 13, you can be imprisoned. Before that, the line was 14. And you'd say, all right, fight like in India, you can fight a non-violent fight. You don't have to throw stones, you can just have demonstrations. Why not? And I tell you, I don't think that Israel allows even a non-violent fight. And you have heard about the cases of Rachel Corrie, of course, in Gaza, that was part of a non-violence reaction. And the case of Tristan Anderson, who was, I would say, holding the flag of non-violence in the struggle in support of the Palestinians, and was shot in his head and is until now crippled. Rachel Corrie died. So practically Israel does not recognize, doesn't want even to give life to such a non-violent struggle. They are tolerant. They will accept stones, Molotov cocktails because they can come and sentence the people and oppress them in prisons, but they are totally against non-violent struggle. The right for life. You know by now, if you are following the news, that many Palestinians are being killed, targeted killing, they call it. We went even to the Supreme Court, where there was a public committee against torture, and the Supreme Court confirmed the possibility to kill people, although they are not in the action, just if there is enough information saying, or convincing probably, the army that that person might, in the future, commit an offense, a security offense. And another scandalous case where a soldier killed a Palestinian who was already neutralized. He tried to stab another soldier, and he was shot, and was lying on the ground, bleeding. But in that case, it was photographed, and therefore, it was very clear that that soldier, Loa Zaria, just murdered him in cold blood, as the court decided. But he was brought to trial in the military court because there was this video. Nobody could deny it. And in the military court, after talking about the purity of the army, of the arms, of the Israeli army, purity of the arms, yeah, they sentenced him for manslaughter to what was 18 months imprisonment, and it was mitigated to 14 months now, just a few days ago. While I tell you that kids, young kids, who did not kill anyone, but did act with violence, whether stabbing or attacking policemen with Molotov, with a burning device, so Molotov cocktail is a burning device, they would be sentenced to 18 years. Another very, very common thing recently is to increase not only the punishments that are intolerable, I feel, but also the fines imposed on many youngsters. Hundreds of thousands of shekels fines to every, even if he's young, a young, of course it doesn't work, it's a family that has to suffer it, for compensation to the victims. While we are fighting in military courts, in civil courts, in order to get some compensation to some of the Palestinian victims, and we usually fail. I would take you with me, but I'm not sure that you will be able to get there. Because once any of you would like to get to Israel, and would land, let's say, the airport, and you will be in the right age, or right color, or have an Arab name, or maybe they checked before, famous as activists, you will be asked to give all the information about the how to enter your Facebook, and the Facebook will be checked, and if you have a telephone, of course, the telephone will be checked, and if you don't have a telephone, it's a good reason to suspect you. Whatever you do before you enter the country, and many of you would be denied, and when we try to go to the courts against this denial, we usually fail because they found some like in the Facebook for, I don't know, Palestinian poem or poet or picture or anything that has to do with solidarity with Palestine. So I'm not sure we will be able to enter, but I do think at this point specifically, I'm finished. At this point specifically, I do think that there should be some demand not only for the BDS, but for mutuality. It means Israelis go all over, all the time, and they indulge this freedom and this free access to wherever they go. And I think that if any of the Canadians, and I'm sure there have been some, are victims for this interrogation before they can enter Israel, there should be a demand to the Canadian state to make the same interrogations to the Israelis. Means, what have you done in the army? Did you serve in the occupied territories? Where do you live? Are you a settler? It's against the international law. You are breaching the international law, etc., etc., etc. Have you been a member of a fascist organization? Have you been attacking couples of Jews and Palestinians because you are in the organization of the Habah fire? Or there are many questions to be asked. And I think that at least we can add or try to turn the Israelis not to be that popular. Thank you.